Well, if you have your Bible, turn with us tonight to the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter number 5. 2 Chronicles, chapter number 5. And I want to give you the message that God has impressed upon my heart for this hour and hope it can be a blessing to you tonight. 2 Chronicles, chapter number 5. If you're able, let's stand as we read God's word tonight. 2 Chronicles, chapter number 5. You'll find the context of the scripture that I'm reading. They have now come to the point Solomon has built the house of God. And you know, anybody that studies the Word of God, you understand that it was his father David who had a desire to build God's house, but God wouldn't allow David to build it. But Solomon, his son, now has completed the work of the house of God, and they're gathering here to dedicate the house of God in this scene. And the Bible says this in chapter 5 of 2 Chronicles and verse number 1. Thus all the work that Solomon made for the house of the Lord was finished. And Solomon brought in all the things that David his father had dedicated, and the silver and the gold and all the instruments put he among the treasures of the house of God. Then Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the chief of the fathers of the children of Israel, unto Jerusalem to bring up the ark of the covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. Wherefore all the men of Israel assembled themselves unto the king in the feast, which was in the seventh month. And all the elders of Israel came, and the Levites took up the ark. And they brought up the ark and the tabernacle of the congregation and all the holy vessels that were in the tabernacle. These did the priests and the Levites bring up. Also King Solomon and all the congregation of Israel that assembled unto him before the ark sacrificed sheep and oxen, which could not be told nor numbered for multitude. And the priests brought in the ark of the covenant of the Lord unto his place, to the oracle of the house, into the most holy place, even under the wings of the cherubims, for the cherubims spread forth their wings over the place of the ark, and the cherubims covered the ark and the staves thereof above. Verse 11, please, for the sake of time. And it came to pass when the priests were come out of the holy place, for all the priests that were present were sanctified, and did not then wait by course. Also the Levites, which were the singers, all of them of Asaph, of Heman, of Jeduthun, with their sons and their brethren, being arrayed in white linen, having cymbals and psalteries and harps, stood at the east end of the altar, and with them 120 priests sounding with trumpets. It came even to pass, as the trumpeters and singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music, and praise the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever, that then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word, and I pray, God, that you would help us tonight now in this place. Father, I pray you touch me, Lord. Give me that liberty I need to bring the message, God, to speak to our hearts. Lord, I pray that you'd help each one that's gathered here. Bless every man of God. I pray every congregation that's represented here tonight. God, would you bless them in a great and a mighty way. And Father, help us to leave saying it's been good to be in the house of God. And Father, I pray you'll bless the furtherance of the meeting now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. In the Word of God that we've read tonight, we find the scene that they have gathered here to dedicate the house of God. If you understand what all went into building the house of God, you realize there's been a lot of work that has went in to bring them to the point that they're at right here. Matter of fact, there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that has went into bringing them to this moment that we read right here in the Word of God. It started with the vision of David in his heart, and on through his son Solomon. And then it began on the mountain ranges of Syria as those Zidonians and those men that Solomon sent there to cut down the majestic cedars of Lebanon. And as they shipped those back to Jerusalem, all of the things that went into bringing them to the place that the house of God was finished. Matter of fact, there'd been a lot of work put into it. The Bible said they had sacrificed so much of oxen and sheep that it was so much multitude it couldn't be numbered. So here the people are. They have labored. They have worked. They have fulfilled a vision that God had placed in their heart. And now they've come to the place. They've all assembled. They're there in their fine array. They're there with the instruments of music. They're there with the singers in order. And all of a sudden, they begin to sing and to praise God, for His mercy endureth forever. Hallelujah. And the Bible says that when they did that, that something very mysterious took place at the house of God. The Bible said there in verse number 13, he said, "And praise the Lord, saying, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever." That then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord, so that the priest could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. We understand this is the Shekinah glory of God came in the midst of the house of God. Here they, listen, I've been around long enough, I'm old enough, that I have been in the house of God a few times in my life when the cloud showed up. I wish it was every Sunday. I wish it was every time that we came that that happened. But I promise you, there's some older folks in here tonight. There's days you look back over your life and you remember being in God's house when God showed up and manifested His presence in such a way that you left there saying, "I've never seen it on that fashion before." I'm talking about changed forever because of the presence of a holy God. Amen. I thought about here in this story, the Bible said that there was an atmosphere change at the house of God. It got foggy. It got thick. Matter of fact, it got so that man had to get out of the way. The priest could not even minister. Hallelujah. I like it when God gets in the midst. And if there's one thing our churches need today, I travel a lot of places, big churches, little churches, country churches, town churches, but I'll tell you what we all need. We need God to send His presence in a great and mighty way in our midst. Amen. We've got the best programs we've ever had. We've got the best facilities we've ever had. We've got all the, we've got the capabilities of the internet. We've got all the media avenues available to us, but I'll tell you what this generation sorely needs tonight is the manifested presence of a holy God in our midst. Amen. I got to thinking about that atmosphere change. What affects atmosphere? What is atmosphere? Well, atmosphere is what you see, what you hear, and what you feel. Now, I know we don't go by feelings, but I'm of that crowd. I like to feel a little bit as I go. Amen. I'm wired like that. I'm just wired. I'm a hillbilly. I'm wired like that. I can't help it. But I'm going to tell you something I thought about. In a lot of places today, the atmosphere needs to be changed. When did God send the cloud? When God's people did what pleased Him. If we get back to doing what God is pleased with, I have a feeling He'd send it a little bit more in our midst in these days. I got to thinking about atmosphere. You know how I'm wired, preacher. I think weird. My brain is wired weird. And I was at the house one day, and I got to thinking about an illustration for this message. And I brought my illustration tonight with me, and everybody here is going to be able to identify with what I'm doing here tonight. And I'll let you see this first, what I got here. And I'll hold it up. I'll try so everybody can see what I got in my hand here. But I've got a thermometer like you put on the front porch post at the house to tell you what the temperature is. And this is just a regular run-of-the-mill thermometer. And I got to thinking about this. I'm thankful the Lord lets me preach this message because I get to carry my own thermometer to church with me. And that can really save your life in some Baptist churches because it'll let you know when it's getting deathly cold and you can do something about it. There's a lot of places the wind chill is pretty bad, and there's a lot of places where there's not any warmth, and boy, it sure would be good to have your own thermometer when you go to church with you. But I got to looking at this thermometer one day. Preacher, I said, you know, this thermometer tonight, when I look at it right now, it says it's about 75 degrees in here. I don't know if that's accurate or not, but it says it's 75 degrees. In other words, this thermometer has diagnosed the atmosphere in this building tonight. It's telling me what the atmosphere is in this building. But do you realize this thermometer can't do one thing to change the atmosphere? It can tell me what it is, but it can't do nothing to change it. I said our pews are sitting full of these folks. They can tell you how the church is. They can tell you how the choir singing is. They can tell you how the Sunday school class is. They can tell you the good and the bad. They can tell you everything, but they're not doing one thing to try to change the atmosphere at the house of God. I got to thinking about that. And I'm thankful I don't have to preach messages like this all the time. Most of the time I preach out of the Bible. But if you can't get nothing out of the Bible, go to Home Depot. They got a lot of good preaching down there at Home Depot. But this message cost me $40. Praise God. I'm glad I don't have to preach all of them like that. Praise God, preacher. But I brought something else with me tonight. I'll hold this up to where you can see it here in the building tonight, and you'll see what I got right here. Matter of fact, I think I saw one on the wall over here. And over here, you see, this fellow will also tell you what the atmosphere is in here. It can diagnose what the temperature is because this is called a thermostat. But the difference between this one and this one can only tell you what it is. Can't do a thing to change it. But this one can diagnose it, and then he can go to work and to try to change the atmosphere. Amen. I don't know about you, but if I got to be one of these and I'm going to be at the house of God, I don't want to just be one of these that can diagnose it. I don't want to just be able to critique everything, but I want to be one that says, by the grace of God, God, would you help me to be an instrument that'll help change the atmosphere at the house of God. I got to thinking about these two. I said, one of these is hooked up. Right. Y'all a little slow in Statesville, North Carolina tonight. Hooked up to the power. Matter of fact, them old boys on the wall are hooked up to something bigger that you can't even see. Hallelujah. Boy, I'm glad, praise God, for some people that knows what it is to hook in to the power of a holy God. If there's one thing that our generation needs, some of them old saints of God of days gone by walked with the power of God on their life. And boy, I tell you, this generation of young people and children need to see some saints of God that's got the power of God plugged into him, hallelujah, and the glory of God on their life, amen. I got messed up as a young preacher just when I surrendered, called to preach. I got hooked up with a bunch of men that taught me how to pray. We'd get together in them prayer meetings, pray all night. And I'm talking about pray and street preach. And biggest crowd I ever preached to was at a rock concert one time. Oh, yeah. A lot of people, these young preacher boys, they're sitting around lamenting. Nobody ain't called me to preach. Nobody ain't given me an opportunity. I found me an opportunity. There's about 2,000 people at a Motley Crue concert one night, and they hadn't opened the doors yet, and there's a standing there with nowhere to go. But I would not advise that to you because it's not for the faint of heart. Amen. But let me tell you something right now. I'm glad for the days that Brother Davey, I got around some men that helped me plug into some old time power. There's some men that taught me how to pray. And there's some places I preach that sometimes people look and they say, oh, Brother Fletcher, he preaches meeting all over the country. They wasn't there the night I was preaching at a rock concert all by myself down there. A couple other boys with me, praise God. But I'll tell you one thing right now. It's some of those moments, preacher. Listen, God did that for me. He said, if you can preach to Motley Crue's crowd, it don't matter how sour an old Baptist looks at you when you're preaching at the house of God. If you can preach the AC/DC crowd down, then you can handle an old crusty Baptist. Amen. Amen. Still to this day, I go in meetings, I'll go preaching somewhere and I'll tell that story. And I had an old boy here a while back came to me at the back door. He said, preacher, I was at that concert. I'd forgot all about that, and I didn't know that was you. But he said, preacher, I'm right with the Lord now. Hallelujah. Can I thank God, amen, for somebody that says, God, use me, plug me in, and help me change the atmosphere. The house of God. One of them's hooked up. The other one just hangs around. There's a lot of these folk that just come to church and hang around. And they're not really invested. Matter of fact, this old boy, these over here, they've been here every service that you've had in this building. These can hang around here a while, and then they can go hang around somewhere else a while. I've had plenty of these down through 24 years. In 24 years, I've had a lot of them hangers around. They'd hang around a little while. And boy, I tell you, sometimes it breaks your heart and say, what did I do wrong? You didn't do nothing wrong, praise God. They're just hanging around for a little while. Amen. But thank God for that crowd that said, I'm going to plug in the place God wants me. I'm not looking to go nowhere. I'm looking to stay and help the man of God and help the church. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but thank God for people who will stay and help in the work of God. Amen. Oh yeah. One's hooked up. The other one just hangs around. I thought about that's the connection issue. And then there's the contact issue of these two. This one's got buttons on it. I got one of these on the wall at my house, and I own the house. And sometimes if I'm sitting there in my easy chair and I don't like the atmosphere, maybe a little cold, the owner walks over and goes to pushing the buttons on this old boy right here. And guess what he starts doing when I go to pushing his buttons? He goes to doing what the owner wants him to do. Amen. You know what helped the atmosphere in our churches? Is when God began to push the buttons of your heart that you'd start responding to what God wants you to do. Hallelujah to his name. You can push on this one all day long and you're not going to get nothing but just stand back at you, praise God. But thank God for some of them little saints that every now and then God goes to touching the buttons of their heart and God goes to moving on them. And by the grace of God, then they respond and the atmosphere begins to change at the house of God, amen. I had one of my deacons a few years ago. I was at home on a Saturday morning, about 11 o'clock, heard a knock on my door. And he was standing there at my door and he had a couple of bags that looked like groceries in his hand. I said, what's this all about? He said, enjoy. And he just walked off and left. I later found out the story. I said, why'd you bring that stuff to my house? He said, I was at the grocery store. And said they had, he said, I'm a steak lover. I love steak. And he said they had them real nice, I'm talking about the expensive steaks on sale. He said, man, I thought this is my lucky day. He said, I went and got four steaks, one for me and my wife, one for my son and my daughter. I went over to the produce section and I got four of the best bacon potatoes they had. I got enough stuff to make a salad for four people. And he said, I went up and I got in line getting ready to check out. And all of a sudden he said, the Holy Ghost said, I bet your preacher likes steak. I bet your preacher's wife likes steak. I bet your preacher's son and daughter likes steak too. And he said, I pulled my buggy out of line. I went back to the meat case. I got four more steaks. He said, I went over to the produce department and I got four more bacon potatoes and I got four more salads. He said, preacher, here it is. Enjoy it. Praise God. You say that ain't much. I'll tell you one thing right now. I thank God for somebody that when the Holy Ghost pushes the buttons of their heart, it may be a little thing God asks you to do. And it might be a big thing, praise God. But thank God for those people, hallelujah, that said, by the grace of God, I want to be an instrument that God can touch and God can move through. And God can use, amen. Last year, at our church, it seemed like we're always taking up a big offering or something. Or, you know, I got some of the givenest people. I know you got them here, preacher. But sometimes as a pastor, you feel like I've just moneyed them to death. It ain't never for me, but I'm trying to help other folk. And we'd just taken up a big amount of money for something. I can't even remember what it was. But there was some news came that there'd been flooding up in the West Virginia area, and some of my preacher friends I preached for up there, one of the preachers had lost, they'd lost their church. 60 families in their church houses were affected by the flooding, and it was on Saturday night that I heard this, and I went to church the next morning, and I said, I didn't feel like we could take an offering because I feel like we'd already just given to his down to where he couldn't do anything right then. But my heart was broke for him. And I got up that morning before Sunday school and I said, folks, I said, I don't know if you've seen the devastation up there in West Virginia, but I said, I know some of those folks. And I said, there's some good churches up there and good men of God, good people. And I said, I don't know if we can do anything, but I said, I tell you what I want you to do. I want you to just pray about what God would have us to do. I didn't tell him I was going to take an offering. I just said, I want you to pray about what God would have us to do. Nothing else was said. I preached that morning, and after I closed the service, I was shaking hands with some folks, and all of a sudden, a quiet young boy in our church, a young man that's got a wife and two little children, just common people, they're not wealthy by any stretch of the imagination, and one of the quietest boys you'll ever see, just humble, quiet. He walked up to me, shook my hand, and when he shook my hand, I noticed he stuck a note in my hand. And on that note that day, after I got to where I could see it, I realized he had stuck a check in my hand as well. And this is what the note said. It said, Pastor, I just want you to know I love you with all of my heart. And then the note said this, and I don't know what God wants you to do for West Virginia, but I know what he wants me to do. Amen. And I looked and there was a $1,000 check from a little family that probably didn't have $1,000 extra to spare. But he had wrote that note, said, I know what God, you know what the problem was? God touched the buttons of his heart and he responded. Hallelujah. Now some of you sitting here said, Lord, I hope God don't touch my heart to write $1,000 check. Some of y'all couldn't handle it. God won't do that. God's just trying to get some of you by your preacher a steak, praise God. You gotta crawl before you can walk, praise God. Amen. I don't even know if you like steak or not, praise God. Oh, okay, all right. Hallelujah then. Well, I'm a preaching right then. Amen. But I was going to tell you, he responded. Yes, sir. I got up that night at the church. I said, folks, I said, I had somebody bring me a check for $1,000. Didn't tell them who it was. I said, we're going to do it like this. We're not taking up an offering, but if you got anything you'd like to give, just get it to some of us. We'll see if they get it. Within 2 days, we took up $10,000. $10,000 not even taking up an offering. In hindsight, I probably should have took an offering. If I got $10,000 not taking one, I might have got $20 if I'd have took one. But the fact of the matter is, it started with one of these in the pews. When I said, I just want you to pray what God have you to do. And God went to pushing the buttons. And the old boy said, well, I don't know them people up there, Lord, but if you want me to, here it is. Praise God. I got news for you. What our churches need to change the atmosphere is some people willing to move when God begins to deal with our hearts. Hallelujah. There's the connection issue. One's hooked up, one hangs around. There's the contact issue. This one's got buttons that can be pushed. And then there's the command issue. What do you mean by that, preacher? With them buttons, you see what it is. When you push them buttons, you're programming it. What you're doing, you're putting in it what you want it to do. And then after you put it in there and you walk away, it'll go about doing it. Isn't that what your preacher's trying to do on Sunday morning when he preaches? He's trying to put something in your life. He's trying to put something in there that will manifest itself on the outside of these walls. He's trying to put something in your life that you'll go about doing. Not just be a hearer of the word, but be a doer of the word. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but thank God for those people. There's a lot of people. I go all over the country preaching, and I see preachers wearing themselves out. Frustrated, worn to a frazzle, trying to program a bunch of thermometers. There's some folks sitting in Baptist church pews, you couldn't put a blessing in a bucket and pour it on them. Amen. But thank God for them sitting there that says, preacher, tell me what the book says. Preacher, preach to me. Help me, preacher. I'm glad there's a God that if you're hungry for it, God will give it to you. Amen. I thank God, hallelujah, for the day that some men of God put some things in my life. Hey, some people along the way. I thought about this when I was just a young boy. My daddy bought me a guitar. I had an uncle played. He taught me 3 chords. G, C, and D, and all of us amateur guitar players still are hung on them 3 chords. And that day when he bought me that guitar, preacher, I didn't know I had really a gift to sing or anything like that. And I sure didn't think about that one day God would use me to write songs. But I started playing that little old guitar because somebody put something into my life. I didn't go buy a guitar. Somebody else went and bought it. Said, here, son, this will be something you can carry with you the rest of your life. And then I had some people that put into me. And the next thing you know, God started putting into me. And next thing you know, started singing a little bit. And I said, Lord, would you help me write a song? Next thing you know, started writing songs. And people started singing along with us. And the next thing you know, everywhere I go now, everybody thinks I'm a great songwriter. Praise God. It ain't nothing. Listen, it started because somebody put something in me. That's why I wonder why we ain't trying to put more in these kids that come in our churches. Oh, we take them. I'm not against ball. I'm not against none of that stuff. I love a good ball game, but I'll tell you, you ought to put something into them that they can carry with them when they're not able to carry the ball, when they're not able to hit the bat with the bat. You ought to put something in them they can carry with them that'll be a blessing to the work of God. Hallelujah. There's the contact issue. There's the command issue. And then there's the conversation issue. What do you mean, preacher? Sometimes I'm sitting up there at the house, and it'll get a little cold. I'm sitting there in the quietness of the living room, and I'll hear a little clicking noise over on the wall. And then all of a sudden, when I hear that little clicking noise, all of a sudden I feel the atmosphere to begin to change all around me. Amen. You know what changed it? This old boy kicked in. There's a lot of times we come to the church house and the atmosphere's a little cold. What God needs is some people in the pews that'll kick in when they need to. I thank God for them people that, praise God, they didn't come for me to have to pump them up and prime them. I've had some of them little saints down through the years. I used to have an elderly lady in our church. She's in heaven now, Miss Ida. And she, I'll tell you what, she'd come ready. And I remember I was just a young preacher. We was there on a Wednesday night. I was just a young preacher. We didn't have a big crowd at that time. And I was doing something real spiritual on Wednesday night. I hadn't preached or anything. I was just making the announcements. Y'all know how spiritual the announcements are. I was just there making the announcements that night on a Wednesday night. Everybody's tired. Everybody just drug in. And all of a sudden, I'm making the announcements. I'm reading them off, and I hear a noise. I just hear a noise in the pews. And I look back, and Miss Ida stood up. She's standing up, looking up like she's looking up into heaven. And when she'd get happy, her face would glow. She'd just glow. I can almost picture how Moses' face looked when he came off of the mountain. Miss Ida's face would shine. Brother Allen can tell you, I'm telling you the truth. Sure enough truth tonight. And she was standing there, and she's just clapping her little hands. And she's just going, praise the Lord. Glory. And I watched her reach up and pull heaven down in a service. Amen. That night. And for the next hour and a half, I don't even know what all happened. Altars filled up multiple times, and it's because somebody kicked in. Somebody said, hallelujah. We didn't come to church for announcements. We come for the one that controls it all, hallelujah, to show up and help us, amen. Need some people to kick in. Every now and then your preacher needs somebody to kick in. I was preaching a meeting years ago in North Carolina. I'll not say where. It's a pretty good sized church, about 150 people. And that night I was preaching and I was getting amens along. And all of a sudden in the middle of amens, a fella took a shouting spell. I'm talking about he was plugged into the glory. I mean, it got to the point I kind of was scanning the crowd while I was preaching to see where he's at. I wanted to go sit next to him. I never could spot him, so I kept preaching. And a few minutes, he struck up again, had the awfulest shouting spell you've ever heard in your life. Done that two or three times while I was preaching. After the service, I was talking to the pastor. I said, preacher, I said, thank you for letting me come. I've enjoyed being here tonight. I said, but I got to ask you a question. I said, that man that got happy and shouted tonight while I was preaching about three times, I said, where was he sitting? I said, I couldn't never see him. Where was he sitting? He looked at me and grinned real big. He said, well, preacher, to be honest with you, he wasn't here. I said, say what? He said, he wasn't here. I said, what do you mean he wasn't here? I said, I heard him shout three times. He said, no, I've got that on tape. And he said, every time you'd say something I really approved of, I'd nod my head at the sound man and he'd hit play. Honest, it happened. As sure as I'm standing here tonight, it happened. You say, what'd you say, preacher? I said, anyway, I can get a copy of that tape. Praise the Lord. I said, hallelujah. I said, preachers all over this country starving to death for somebody to get with them while they preach. I said, if we can figure out how to rig up a button on the pulpit so that when you need it the most, amen, you got it. But can I say to you, thank God for some people that every now and then the Holy Ghost will kick them in, amen, and they'll help us at the house of God. I had Brother Ron Martin and the Rollins singing for me last year. Brother Ron is Miss Kyla Rollins' brother. And Miss Kyla is one of the greatest songwriters of our generation, probably the greatest. Wrote over 6,000 songs, if I'm not mistaken. And Brother Ron and her and the family was raised by a little old Baptist preaching daddy and a little praying mama. A lot of her songs are inspired by her mama's praying and her daddy's preaching. Brother Ron told this story, and I thought it's funny. I said, I got to tell that. He said, you know, sometimes when you're preaching, you struggle a little bit. And anybody that's preached in these days, you understand that the struggle is real. Amen. But anyway, he said one night, Daddy said the service was tight, wasn't no liberty. And said Daddy was a floundering around just struggling to beat the band to try to preach. Said, Daddy had struggled, tried to preach, and Mama's over there trying to pray. Said, nothing would never break loose. And said, finally, Daddy just floundered around about three quarters of the way through the message. Said, my Mama stood up on that side of the building. Said, she stood up, called her husband's name, and said, honey, just shut it down. Just shut it down. Just shut it down. And I thought, I didn't know you could do that. I did not know that somebody could rescue you when you were struggling trying to preach. And then I got so upset that my wife had never loved me enough to rescue me. Your wife ain't never loved you enough either. No, what ours do is they say, look at him right there. He's struggling tonight. Hey, everybody, look at him right there. But thank God for those people. I don't know if anybody's getting anything out of this or not, but I'm enjoying it, praise God. Amen. But thank God for those people who will kick in when you need them. When the church is going through a rough spell, they'll kick in. when it gets a little cold, they say, they're not like this fellow. They say, well, our church is so cold, nobody goes to the altar anymore. And boy, there ain't just much of happening at our church. Thank God that everybody ain't like this crowd right here. But thank God for that crowd that says, you know what? It may be a little cold. And they may be right about that. But by the grace of God, I'm going to do everything I can to help change the atmosphere. Amen. I'm going to do what God would have me to do. Hallelujah. There's the conversation. Just kicks in. And then last of all, there's the call issue of these. What do you mean by the call? Well, I ain't never heard one of these call me. But somehow or another, when I'm sitting in my chair and I get cold, I feel compelled to draw near to it. Have you ever seen a saint of God that you just get around them and things would start changing even in your own life? I've seen some men of God that I just, they wouldn't even know it, and I'd be as cold as I could be. I'd just get around them, listen to them talk. Next thing you know, the atmosphere's a changing, preacher.
Yes, sir.
Some of them little granny women get talking about how good God's been to them and all the things he's done down through their life. And the next thing you know, you feel like you're warming up a little bit. And it's all because you drew near to one that knew what it was to change the atmosphere. This world is a cold, dark world. Sinners out there are in a dog-eat-dog world. They're not used to seeing anybody that loves them, used to seeing anybody that cares. But I'll tell you one thing right now. When they get in trouble, I'll tell you who they're going to draw near to. When they see that old boy on the job that walks with Jesus every day. When they see that lady over there at that place she works in the office and they see her faith in Christ, they're going to draw near to that individual because they see something real in their life. I don't know about you, but I want to be the kind of Christian that others could feel compelled. Said, preacher, would you just pray for me? Preacher, would you help me a little bit? Preacher, I want to do God's will. Thank God, I'm glad we can be an influence on somebody's life. This one right here changes the atmosphere. This one don't. It just tells you what it is. But I'm glad there when Solomon gathered them all together. They had already put in the work. They had sacrificed. They'd come ready to church. And all of a sudden they began to sing. And they'd done a lot up to that point, but when they done all they could do, then God did the rest. And God sent the cloud. God sent the cloud. Don't we need the cloud to show up in our services? Don't we need the cloud to show up? I don't know about you, but I believe we need it worse than we ever have. And I don't know about you, I want to be an instrument God can use to help change the atmosphere. Father, I thank you for what you've done for us tonight. Thank you for helping us, Lord. I pray, God, that you take this message now to the hearts of this people. God, you know the need of the hour, Lord, as this pastor comes. I pray, God, that you give him wisdom. Help us tonight, Lord. Help us to be that instrument. Help us to be a vessel, Lord, that can be used to help change the atmosphere in the house of God. And Father, we'll give you praise and honor and glory for it's in Jesus' name. Let's stand with our heads bowed. Preacher, you come tonight. God bless you.
I'm going to get Miss Amy play. Brother James will have a song in a minute. Listen, boy, that's a lot of thought to what he just said tonight. When you go to church, you ought to make a difference. You ought to make a difference. Some of you from different churches tonight, listen, I've seen people that go to Jubilee somewhere and they'll worship God at that Jubilee. Then they go back home to their home church and just sit there like a knot on a log. Boy, their preacher needs some help, needs some encouragement. I'm going to tell you what, but I know where to look around in the church, Brother Shelton. When I'm a struggling some, I know where to look. I know where those thermostats are. I do. I wonder tonight how many of you would say, preacher, I just don't want to go to church. I just don't want to show up, but I want to make a difference. I want to make a difference in the services I'm in. I want to make a difference in my church. I want to make a difference in my kids. I want to make a difference in the people I'm around. I just don't want to be part. I don't want to tell what the problem is. I want to be part of the solution. I wonder tonight, maybe you'd like to just slip out of that seat right now. Come and say, Lord, help me. That's right. That's right. Just come on. Help me tonight to make a difference in changing things. Use me, Lord, to make a difference. Use me to make a difference. Amen. That's right. Just keep on coming tonight. Use me, Lord, to make a difference. Boy, I thank God many a time I've been preaching somewhere and man, I just couldn't get going. I mean, it just hard. Then somebody in that auditorium got touched. Somebody got some help. Next thing you know, everybody's getting help. That's right. Hallelujah, Jesus. Every pastor tonight thanks God he's got some people that can help change the atmosphere.
There's a voice calling me.
That's right.
From an old rugged tree, and it whispers, draw closer to me. Leave this world far behind. There are new heights.
Oh, I'm thinking tonight about several dead people down through the years.
New place in me.
Oh, I'm glad I had them around.
You will find. For whatever it takes,
oh, yeah,
to draw closer to you, Lord.
That's what.
That's what I'll be willing to do. For whatever it takes to be more like you. That's
amen,
what
Marquise. Hallelujah,
I'll be
buddy.
Willing to do.
I'm sure some of you men of God know what I'm getting ready to say tonight. Look up here at me just a moment. Brother Fletcher does as well. I've had people come up to me and say, preacher, you going to be here so and so or so and so? And I said, well, I got to be, you know, here, there, or the other. And I've had people literally say these words to me. They'd say, preacher, it's just a different atmosphere when you're not there. Now, that don't mean I'm more spiritual than anybody. That don't mean I know God better than anybody. But I made my mind up a long time ago. When I go to church, I'm going to go to church. And I know you folks, listen, I'm pastor, you work hard during the day. Some of you in meals, some of you in offices, some of you outside in the sun, the heat, or cold. And you put in the day when you come home and rush your little family getting ready and get in your car and go down to the house of God. And when you walk in, buddy, some of you about to go down for the last time. Some of you going through the battle. Some of you need encouragement. And the last thing you need, old preacher, ain't nothing but a thermometer. You need somebody to get around you and say, you know what? I left encouraged tonight because that man or that woman encouraged me to change that atmosphere. And let's be honest, it wasn't Solomon that changed the atmosphere. It was the Holy Ghost. But aren't you glad some people just got the Holy Ghost in them? Hallelujah. Preacher, thank you tonight. Thank you tonight. I'd heard about that. And I'm so glad. I like it, buddy. I love Brother Leonard Fletcher. Just real, real, real. Amen. Listen, he's got to preach with Dr. Brown down there, 1,000 people down there. And then he'll go up to the country church. May not be 15, 18, but he won't change the lick. Preach the same way. And that's what I love about Brother Leonard Fletcher. I've had a privilege preaching up Mountain City, and I tell you, you won't find a finer church. God doing a great work. The song's a privilege, sing different one. Brother Fletcher's Road. And I heard you the other day on Facebook where you were singing with him, Doug, and I think up by the church. His races wasn't it? You were singing with that song, Doug. I'm not ashamed. I couldn't talk you into singing a little something, could I? I got piano players can play about anything now. Would y'all like to hear him sing a song for you? Amen. Listen, we moved up in the preacher. Come here, man. We moved up in the world. The last time he preached for us, he preached on Preparation H. So we have moved up in the world. I'm telling you. Yeah.
That's for that pain that nobody wants
told
to talk
about. Told you what? Oh.
I knew somebody was going to do that.
Yeah.
I used to like you.
Well, while he's getting the song ready, we'll sing Happy Birthday.
No, you don't need to sing Happy Birthday. Today is my birthday, but that's not, that's, all that means us is that 58 years ago, my mama was having a hard time.
All right, we want, will you sing something for us, preacher?
Yeah, I will. I'm not ashamed, Alan.
Yeah. Y'all, let's just stand up. We don't need to sit down. This song right here, you put it out on the Lord.
It's one he wrote. I wrote this song probably 28 years ago. I was at work that day. I wasn't a pastor at that time. I was working in the grocery store there, stocking groceries on the dog food aisle. And these words started coming to me. The old devil, he's saying, you know what, you ought to be ashamed of some of the stuff you've done in your life. And you know the accuser of the brethren, how he does. And I said, well, you're right. I said, but I'm not ashamed to stand and say that I love Jesus. And I grabbed a piece of cardboard and I wrote those words down and went home and told my wife. I said, I think I've wrote a song today. Let's see if we can put some music to it. And we started singing it. Everywhere we sung it, people got blessed by it. And back in 2006, the inspiration, Brother Joe Arthur gave them this song. And they recorded it and sent it out all across the country. And it was nominated for Song of the Year in Southern Gospel Music in 2006, wrote on the dog food aisle of a grocery store. Only God can do that. I hope me and Alan don't mess it up tonight. Ashamed to stand and say that I love Jesus. I'm not ashamed to say I'm trusting in His Word. I'm not ashamed in lifting high that blood-stained banner, because I'm saved. I'm not ashamed. Sometimes we as Christians, we set up on the shelf. We're ashamed to lift our hands in praise. We wait on someone else. But Jesus died at Calvary. God's plan He did fulfill. And that is why I stand today, trying to do His will. I'm not ashamed to stand and say that I love Jesus. I'm not ashamed to say I'm trusting in His Word. I'm not ashamed in lifting high that blood-stained banner, because I'm saved. I'm not ashamed. Oh yes, praise God, I'm still not ashamed. Yes, listen to this verse. In this life we have His blessings, yet we fail to praise His name. He said if we were ashamed of Him, to us He'd be the same. When He gave His life at Calvary, He did it for all men, so that we could stand and gladly say, oh, we've been born again. I'm not ashamed to stand and say that I love Jesus. I'm not ashamed to say I'm trusting in His Word. I'm not ashamed in lifting high that blood-stained banner, because I'm saved. I'm not ashamed because He saved me. I'm not ashamed.
I'm not ashamed. Brother Davey, I was thinking about something tonight. Brother CT preached and he sung. Brother Joe preached and he sung. Brother Fletcher preached and he sung. And then I got to think about this, but you sing. The only preacher that does not sing, you're looking at. But now, if we was back at that AC/DC concert, no, never. Now, you want to sing one for us? I mean, you know, this is Jubilee. They ain't got nowhere to go. They're just going to get up tomorrow and come to church.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Don't sing one for us, please.
Yeah. How I came to love these pilgrims is to me a great surprise, and the way the Lord has led me is a wonder in my eyes. Oh, I said I'd never be one, but I'm happy now to say that although I used to hate them, I am one of them today. And now I feel constrained to tell it, and I'm happy now to say that although I used to hate them, I am one of them today. Well, I knew this world despised them, so I said, "Will never do. I will lose my reputation if I join that noisy crew." But then I heard in tones of thunder, "You must surely go their way." It is said, taught hallelujah, I am one of them today. And now I feel constrained to tell it, and I'm happy now to say that although I used to hate them, I am one of them today. Oh, I'm so glad that I have joined them, for they led me to the right, and I'm going to stay among them, ever walking in the light. And then someday I'll join their number over on the other shore. It is finished, hallelujah, I'm a pilgrim evermore. And now I feel constrained to tell it, and I'm happy now to say that I'm glad I now can own him, and I'm one of them today. Oh yes, I'm one of them today.